This conference will now be recorded.
Good morning, all of you. So we were discussing the different phases of clinical trials. So we finished the phase 1, phase 2, and phase 3. So mainly in all the phases of clinical trial, what you need to focus is the objectives of each phases. Objectives, why each phase, what is the objective of each individual phase, and who are the participants in each phase, and also like number of participants and duration of the phases. These are important points that you need to remember when you study the different phases of clinical trial. Today we will see the phase 4 or the post-marketing surveillance. So phase 4 is called as post-marketing surveillance, or where you come across this pharmacovigilance program. So that is also an important phase. So we have discussed in preclinical phase, we are doing all the animal studies and how the particular drug is distributed in different tissues in the animals, and how it is metabolized, and what are the effects on the, like, pharmacodynamics and pharmacokinetic studies are done specifically in the animals. And we also determine the LD50. LD50 is a dose at which when a new chemical agent is given, like 50% of the animals are expired. So that is LD50. So LD50 determination is also done in the preclinical phase or animal studies. Then in phase 1, we discussed, it is involves few volunteers. So majority of the time, healthy volunteers are involved in phase 1 studies. And except in few cases where the particular drug or new chemical entity is going to cause severe cytotoxic effects, then at that point, we recruit the patients. Then here also we determine the pharmacokinetics, metabolic rate, and freedom, like how tolerable is the patient when different doses is given. Then so here, as I said, like drugs with serious side effects are tested only in patients. Then phase 2, where we actually start to find out the pharmacodynamic effect. In phase 1, mainly we focused on the tolerability of the particular drug, where we didn't see, we just saw the toxicity profile or side effect profile and tolerability. But in phase 2, we actually begin to investigate the pharmacodynamic effects or the intended indication, whether it is working or not. The confirmation part will begin in the phase 2 studies. Then again, the toxicity study profile would be continued in phase 2, of clinical trial as well. Then phase 3, where most of the randomized control, RCTs, will be in phase 3. Yesterday we discussed, exactly we discussed the, like in phase 3, how the RCT is done, where sometimes we give placebo, then we give two different doses of the same drug, and we see, we randomly give to the patients. It can be blind study, double blind study, triple blinded study, etc. So all this happens in phase 3. Now coming to phase 4, phase 4 studies are very important because it is done to identify adverse events which are rare. So that if adverse events or side effects which they were not able to find out during phase 1, phase 2, and phase 3 can be detected in the post-marketing surveillance. So once like this happens after the approval of the drug. So after phase 3, what the manufacturer will do is, the manufacturer will apply to the regulatory agency. For example, in India, the manufacturer, the company, has to apply to the DCGI, Drug Control General of India, whereas in US it is to the FDA. So similarly, in different countries we have different regulatory authorities, and once phase 3 part is over, they submit the application, which is called as new drug application. So initially we see like four introducing or to begin a study in human beings or to begin clinical trials or human trials, we have to submit the investigational new drug application. So investigational new drug application is submitted to the regulatory authority soon after the animal studies or soon after the preclinical study. So once they get investigational new drug application clear, then they can do the phase 1, phase 2, phase 3. Then once phase 3, till phase 3 part, if the drug has successfully come through, then they can submit the new drug application to the regulatory authority. Then regulatory authority will give approval and then they can start marketing the drug. So even at that stage also, we can see that a lot of drugs, we can see, we have a lot of examples where at the post-marketing surveillance stage, they have been banned. So many examples are there. So why we have to go for this post-marketing surveillance study? Because many of the adverse events are we know that in phase 1, phase 2 and phase 3, there are limited participants. In phase 3, we saw maximum participant is 3,000. So our drug is our drug in question is exposed to only just 3,000 participants. So maybe the incidence of one adverse drug reaction is 1 in 1 lakh patients. So if the drug is never exposed to 1 lakh patients, we will not be able to identify that. So many adverse drug reactions or adverse events or side effects are not recognized in the phase 1, phase 2 and phase 3 studies. Main reason is the exposure is less. Only maximum of 3,000 patients are exposed during the phase 3 trial. And another reason is we can see that some of the adverse events or ADR or side effects, they happen only after long-term exposure. Only if the drug, if they continue to use the drug for many years, 4-5 years, after maybe 4 to 7 years, after they get exposed to the drug, they continuously take the drug for chronic illnesses like arthritis or diabetes or hypertension. We give them medication and if it is well controlled, they'll continue to take the medication for many years. So if they take the medication for many years, then only certain adverse drug reactions will be manifested. So only long-term administration for certain adverse events to happen, it requires long-term administration. So we discussed in phase 1, phase 2 and phase 3, how many, maximum of 3 to 5 years, phase 3 is the extended duration. When compared to phase 1 and phase 2, phase 3 is for around 3 to 5 years. So maximum of 5 years only the patient gets exposed to the drug. So we are not able to find out the long-term effects. So that is another reason. So first one is there is limited exposure, limited participants are involved during the various phases of the study. So when some adverse drug reactions are, if their incidence is low, then it will be manifested only if it is exposed to a general population or more population. If it is exposed, then only the ADR will be manifested. Another reason is the duration of exposure, because in different phases we have the time limitation is there. So beyond certain ADRs are happening only after very long term exposure. So this is another reason why a lot of ADRs are identified in the post marketing studies. So if we are not vigilant about it, what happens? These ADRs will go unnoticed and it will be causing severe harmful effects, like mortality and morbidity would be increased. If we have developed this drug with great pain and great so much of resources, why we are investing so much to improve the health, to improve the quality of life of the patients, we are doing all this, and in the end, if a drug has come into the market which is causing lot of adverse effects, then the intention itself is not achieved. So it is important that we do this proper pharmacovigilance role. That is why it is called as vigilance. We have to be vigilant about the various drugs that are marketed in the that are marketed. So it is important. Otherwise, if it goes unnoticed, the morbidity rate, mortality rate would go high. So post-marketing surveillance is an important thing, and everyone, even from right from the consumers, all the consumers, healthcare professionals, all has to equally take part in this particular part, because Anyone, like we can see in pharmacovigilance, in majority of the countries in the US and also in India, we have this spontaneous reporting. Spontaneous reporting, so anyone can report about the adverse drug reaction. So, so all of us has to be very cautious, especially pharmacists has to be very cautious, and they have to feel responsible to report the various adverse drug reactions that is happening. So pharmacovigilance program is important. So it is mainly the main objective of the pharmacovigilance is again to assure the safety of medicines and also protect the consumers from the harmful effects. So pharmacovigilance program's main primary objective is to assure that the medicines that are in the market is safe and the consumers are protected from all its harmful effects. So this is another reason is like only in the ADRs are only seen in the general population. Then like if ADRs are more reported for a particular drug, if a lot of ADRs are like the incidence, if more from different parts of the country, if same the adverse event is being reported, and if it like up to almost 50% of cases are reporting ADRs, then again the regulatory authority has the responsibility to ban that particular drug. So the ADR, that is why we like this ADR reporting has the power to even ban a particular drug that has been produced into the market with lots of like after lots of investment. So the ADR reporting is important. Then another in like objective is this post-marketing surveillance studies. It will help to address questions that occur during phase 1 to phase 4 study. So when the study is done during phase 1 or phase 1, phase 2 and phase 3, like lot of questions, like lot of effects will be there, so they cannot completely answer because some requires, as I told earlier, a number of years of exposure. So when such questions are not adequately answered, this particular objective can be met during the phase 4 or post-marketing surveillance. For example, we can come or do these comparison studies. Like already if there is a standard drug available and the new drug is also like just now marketed, then we can compare that two drugs and we can identify which of the drug is better. So comparison studies then with other drugs, and also cost-effective studies also can be done. So cost-effective studies, like the cost-effective studies, what they do is they will determine like if that intervention, if a particular new chemical entity is of worth, like whether it is producing, improving the quality of life of the patient, if that much money is given by the patient, whether the patient is getting the benefit out of it. So if like it will determine whether there is particular benefit for giving the for that particular value that the patient has been given on that. So that is cost effectiveness study. So cost effectiveness study also can be done during this phase 4. I think you will be knowing more when you study this pharmacoepidemiology, or the cost effective analysis, cost benefit analysis are all dealt there. So the cost benefit, cost effective studies are also done, can be also be done in the pharmacovigilance studies or post marketing studies, where you will be able to determine whether the intervention is cost effective or not. Then so here is one example, like rhabdomyolysis. Rhabdomyolysis is an important ADR associated with the use of statins. So we know there are a lot of statins, such as atorvastatin is there, which is the most popular one. Then rosuvastatin is there, which has got makes some added benefit over atorvastatin. So all these, when during the phase 1, phase 2 or phase 3, they were not able to determine the rhabdomyolysis. So during the clinical trials, atorvastatin-induced rhabdomyolysis, they were not able to identify. Why? Because see, you can see that. Here we can see that the incidence of rhabdomyolysis is 1 in 23,000 patients. So rhabdomyolysis, we can see like majority of the patients are getting rhabdomyolysis. We can see the how we can like if the patient is complaining of some new muscle pain when they start to take statins or while they are on statin at any point of time, if the patient is complaining some pain in like new muscles, then we can consider for rhabdomyolysis. So we can see in our like when we go to hospitals, we can see many patients will be experiencing this rhabdomyolysis, but they were not able to determine during the phase 1 or phase 2 or phase 3 studies. Why? Because here we can see that rhabdomyolysis is a severe condition, because if the statin is not withdrawn, or if you are not giving any, like we can give some rhabdomyolysis can be treated with the help of some coenzyme Q, etc. So if not treated off, or if the statin is not withdrawn, it can even cause kidney problems because of the muscle breakdown products. It will cause maybe some acute kidney injury. It can result. So rhabdomyolysis can cause kidney injury also. So it is a severe condition. So but it was not, they were not able to identify this rhabdomyolysis during any of the phases, phase 1, phase 2, phase 3. So why? Because we can see that in phase 2 or phase 3 maximum of only 3,000 patients are involved. So here rhabdomyolysis can be seen in only once about 23,000 patients. So atorvastatin, we can see it is the one of the most popular drug worldwide. We can see atorvastatin is one of the, it was one of the most widely used drug worldwide. It was very effective and it was widely used drug. So imagine once in every 23,000 patients will be getting this problem, rhabdomyolysis. So a lot of patients will be having this, because we know that around 7 million crore people are there. So imagine a lot of patients are receiving this statins. That the statins are first line drug for the cholesterol. So we can see that a lot of patients are receiving, and the incidence is also once in 23,000 patients. So, and it is also severe condition, because rhabdomyolysis can also result in kidney injury. So it is an important thing. So they what they identified. So it was reported, like whenever the muscle damage was seen, rhabdomyolysis was seen, it was reported. So they were able to identify this particular situation. So they can either withdraw the drug, or they can go for some treatment, etc. So that is why it is important that we report the ADRs of all the newly marketed drugs. So why they were not able to identify is because this happens only once per 23,000 patients. In clinical trials, we never use 23,000 patients and all, like even not even near to that. So they have done some studies, and they have found out that like if they follow up 69,000 of statin takers, then only they will be able to confirmly say that one, they can able to observe one episode of rhabdomyolysis. So three times the incidence, they have found that one in 23,000 patients will be getting rhabdomyolysis. So in order to confirm that, they have determined that they have to follow around 69,000 statin takers so that they can confirmly say that one episode of rhabdomyolysis will be seen in 69,000 patients. So how is this possible? How we can involve 69,000 of patients? We cannot do it with the help of clinical trials. So that is why after the drug being marketed, we have to do the studies. The 69,000 persons and all can be included if we do the meta-analysis or the systematic review or meta-analysis is done, where the studies that has happened in various parts of the world, all the literatures that has been released. So what they will do is, imagine this drug is just now released, statin is just now released. So so many reports will be there, ADR reports. So initially it will start as case reports. So any rare ADR is happening, what we will do is we will report as a case report into literatures, like in art, in journals, we will publish it as case reports. Case report means a rare ADR has happened. It can be anything, how they treated, etc. So like from ADR point of view, I'm talking here, we can see that the patient has like, imagine the statin is just now released, and when you went to the hospital, you saw this like after the patient has started taking the statins, he is being developing pain in the some of the muscles. So you have seen, go pull out of the patients, and you explain that in a case report, and it is published in the journal. So this is the first of kind of any literature published in terms of rhabdomyolysis in statins. So that will be there, and also you have started reporting also. So similarly, case reports will be identified from different, like worldwide, in different journals, case report on the rhabdomyolysis, statin-induced rhabdomyolysis would be available, and also this ADRs also would be reported in different countries. That will be the initial phase. Then what happens is, then they will do, so when you search, so another researcher, when he is reading through the articles, he is identifying there are a lot of case reports of statin-induced rhabdomyolysis. So what he will do, he just want to find out how true it is. So he's going to initiate another study with the objective whether statin is causing rhabdomyolysis. So he will start doing the research. Clinical research, he will start doing it, like how we are going to do the project. So from different case reports, he has got some idea. Okay, there are a lot of case report being reported. Case report can be seen in all the different journals, like that statin is producing rhabdomyolysis. So there's a research question in his mind, whether it is really going to cause, because case reports are just rare occurrences that you can see, that you can get from the various journals. So he want to confirm it. So he has the research question in mind, and then he will make the objectives, and he will do the inclusion exclusion criteria, and he will get the ethical approval, institutional ethical committee, and he will start following up patients who are receiving statins in his hospital. So one study. Similarly, it is not just one brain. Worldwide, we can see researchers are like, they want to do new researches. So many people will be seeing the same problem, statin is causing rhabdomyolysis, so they will do the study. So what in after the like after all these people in different parts of the world, they do the study, they will again publish it. So now we have got different articles, different research articles on statin induced rhabdomyolysis. So in a hospital around, like we can see in any nearby hospital here, we can see if they are doing the study for 3 years, around 1,000 patients they will get. So they are following up. Each individual study would be like around 500 to 1,000 patients will be there. So they will be having this study article published on around 1,000 people. So similarly, all the other people also have published the same study with 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 people. So when any, so we can see that now a lot of published article is there on statin-induced rhabdomyolysis, but still we cannot confirm it. Again, how to confirm it? Again, another person who has seen that, like now there are a lot of research articles on rhabdomyolysis-induced statin-induced rhabdomyolysis. So what they do is they will collect all these research articles, and they will do a review on the articles, published research articles. So that is called as a systematic review or meta-analysis. Then he will statistically derive a conclusion. So that is meta-analysis or systematic review. So in such studies, what happens is he is including all these studies. So that means he is including the results of all these patients. So it will be a huge population then. So 500 in one research article, 1000 in another research article. So similarly, like lot of patients are lot of effect of these statins on lot of patients are available when we do systematic review or meta-analysis. Then he will statistically derive the answer. So that is how we can like that is how we do this evidence-based studies. So then we can just confirmly say that statin-induced rhabdomyolysis is very true. Even otherwise, how so all these are part of pharmacovigilance. So if the incidence is very high, because we can see here that even if statin is producing rhabdomyolysis, it is never bad because the incidence is low. 1 in 25,000 patients is can be seen. But if the incidence is so high, what happened? Like we don't have to go, even that much time will not be there to do all the research articles. Even before that, because of all the areas reported worldwide, the drug will be banned. So all these comes under pharmacovigilance. Either like if the incidence of the ADR is high, either there will be increased rate of ADR reporting can be seen and the drug will be immediately banned within 4-5 years. Or again, we can see that like this, initially it will start with case report. Then because of the case report, the people will be starting to do the researches. And after that, based upon the research, systematic analysis or systematic review will be done. And after that only, maybe the drug would be banned. So it can happen in any way. So if the incidence is high, straight away after receiving all the ADRs, the regulatory authority will be banning the particular drug. Then we can also see that adverse drug reactions are areas are not seen in all patients. Like we can see, for example, metformin. We know that metformin causes lactic acidosis, but this lactic acidosis is seen more among renal failure patients or those patients with reduced creatinine clearance. So we can also in post-marketing surveillance, we can also identify the risk factors that are, I think in when we studied ADR, we have also studied various predisposing factors. So how they were able to find out this predisposing factors for any particular ADR, it is based upon the risk factors. So we can see that fluoroquinolones. So fluoroquinolones, one of the ADR is, it can cause fluoroquinolones can cause cartilage loss. So this is mainly seen in young adults, like around in children, like up to the age of 18. So it has to be used very cautiously in people under the age of 18 because fluoroquinolones can affect the developing cartilages. So the people of risk people at risk of getting ADR due to fluoroquinolones, the age group up to the age of 18 years of age. So there are also some risk factors, like whether when there are also certain risk factors that is associated with ADR. So how they are identifying these risk factors, it is also based upon these pharmacovigilance studies. Then risk factors responsible for increased frequency or severity. We can also see that elderly patients, hypotension caused in elderly patients, which is called as this Hypotension, like if antihypertensive is when elderly patients are taking antihypertensives, then they are more prone to hypotension. So there are different risk factors. Then then again areas when we give drugs in combination. So this cannot, these cannot be studied in the phase 1, phase 2 or phase 3. So like we can't include all the patients who are receiving metformin or who is receiving some other painkiller. So when we introduce a drug in the general population only, we will be able to have people who are on other medications, and we can compare the effect of our drug with the when we concomitantly administer it along with other drugs. So concomitant administration effects and all can be identified only during the post-marketing surveillance. So many drug interactions are also identified here. Example, this MAO inhibitors and the styrene containing food, phenelcine. When this drug food interaction also, tyramine containing cheese when administered along with this MAO inhibitors, this tyramine is metabolized by the MAO enzyme, monoamino oxidase enzyme. Tyramine, which is present in some of the food materials such as cheese, is metabolized by the monoamino oxidase. So when we administer monoamino oxidase inhibitors such as phenelcine, what happens is this tyramine is not metabolized, and tyramine, if present in the body, can produce this phenylephrine and epinephrine and all, so which can cause hypertensive crisis can happen. So such drug food interaction are also identified only during this pharmacovigilance studies. So that is the main reason that phenelcine was banned. So these were all identified during the pharmacovigilance period, not during the phase 1, phase 2 or phase 3. So tyramine containing food and MAO inhibitors, drug food interaction effects. These were like really harmful and serious, and it was withdrawn, I guess. So these main objective is, one is long-term side effects can be identified. Then another is, it can the incidence of adverse reaction can also be identified in the post-marketing surveillance. Incidence means like what is the rate of occurrence of adverse drug reaction, like in 1 minute how many patients can be seen. All those are identified during the post-marketing surveillance, and also the risk factors to like which group of people are at risk of getting the ADR, that also are identified during this pharmacovigilance time. Then same, so already non-adverse reaction also we can see whether the frequency is high when introduced in the general population, or the severity, frequency and severity, whether it is increased during when it is introduced in the general population, that can be identified. Then it also helps the pharmaceutical company to determine marketing strategies for medicinal product. Then whatever response any like pharmaceutical company is getting, maybe it can be a negative response, the drug may be having a negative response or positive response. The during the post-marketing surveillance, the pharmaceutical company has to take it positively, and they have to bring the particular improvement in the drug development program. So if they take it as a positive response, it will help to strengthen strengthen the conduct of the clinical trial. So in post-marketing surveillance, we can get either negative response or positive response. This drug company has to take it positively, and they have to bring improvement in the drug development, and also they have to improve the how they have to carefully conduct the clinical trial thereafter. Then again, new areas are also identified during the post-marketing surveillance. Then another important function of post-marketing surveillance is that we can the safety and efficacy can be confirmed in the clinical practice. So in phase two and phase three, mainly we study the indication, whether the indication, the intended indication is seen or not, whether the particular effect that the pharmacological response is produced or not is seen in phase two and phase three. So I think if you remember, we can see that this they determine with the help of endpoints. For example, like if our new chemical entity is an antihypertensive agent, so the endpoint is simple. Very immediately we can find out the reduction of BP. Similarly, anti-diabetic, the important early endpoint is like we can immediately, within next day itself, we will be able to, or within few hours we will be able to identify whether the intended indication is met or not. But in certain illnesses like cancer, or if the endpoint is if the endpoint is very far, for example, whether here we can see whether exogenous estrogen, if postmenopausal women are taking exogenous estrogen, whether it will prevent fracture. So so here the endpoint is preventing fracture. So in the phase one, phase two, or phase three, we will not be able to see whether the exogenous estrogen consumption prevents osteoporosis or not. We are not able to find out, because for a limited period only the estrogen can be, like the effect can be studied, because the duration of the study is maximum 3 to 5 years. So during that limited duration, we cannot confirm whether exogenous estrogen is preventing factor or not. So in such studies, then the endpoint is really far. Or you can see whether any anti-cancer medication, or this HIV or HIV antiviral medications also, the immediate endpoint was like in HIV medication, what we look for, if a particular drug is reducing the viral load and the CD4 count, we can say that particular drug is effective, because we know in HIV the CD4 count should not be high and the viral load should be low. So if any drug is reducing this, we can say that this particular drug is effective. So the endpoint was viral load and viral load reduction and CD4 count increase. So that was the endpoint. But that endpoint they were able to find out. But whether the drug is actually reducing the morbidity and mortality rate, that we cannot find out during the phase one and phase two or phase three study. So this is another important role of post-marketing surveillance, where we can confirm the safety and efficacy profile in the everyday clinical practice, especially in those effects of medicines which are long term, or the endpoint is not immediate, endpoint is far. For example, if we want to know whether certain drug is preventing any disease, example exogenous estrogen reducing preventing fracture in postmenopausal women. Another example is antiviral medications, whether they are actually decreasing the morbidity and mortality rate among the HIV patients. Immediately they may be showing the effect, but in the long run, whether it is actually effective or not can be confirmed with the help of this post-marketing surveillance. Then it also helps to establish adverse drug reactions, which is previously unknown, or which was inadequately quantified. For example, is NSAID and the peptic ulcer disease. So this NSAID induced peptic ulcer disease, they were not able to identify it during, or they had just a clue, maybe a very few patients reported of some symptoms of peptic ulcer. So they were not able to confirm. So during the post-marketing surveillance only, this relation between the NSAID and peptic ulcer disease can be seen. Even now we can see that, for example, some drugs that are causing Clostridium difficile infection, CDI. We can see that certain antibiotics, such as these quinolones, then quinolones, clarithromycin, etc., that can cause this Clostridium difficile infection, where the antibiotic is causing the flora, our beneficial flora, our beneficial microorganisms that are present in our intestine will be reduced when we take antibiotics. So when these beneficial microflora is reduced, what happens is certain other pathogenic organisms, such as Clostridium difficile, can grow, multiply at a higher rate, and can cause severe stomach pain and all. So these drugs, such as these antibiotics, especially the quinolones, can cause this Clostridium difficile infection. So that is an ADR, that certain antibiotics causing this Clostridium difficile infection. So this was identified post-marketing, during the post-marketing surveillance only. Then they were also able to identify certain risk factors also, such as if proton pump inhibitor is also given along, then the incidence of that ADR is even higher. So how they were able to identify, how they were able to define that risk factor, another risk factor for Clostridium difficile infection is, again, the concomitant administration of proton pump inhibitor. So we can see that ADR, we know that the particular antibiotic is causing Clostridium difficile infection, and the incidence is even more when a proton pump inhibitor is also is given. So that is a more like even a risk factor can be identified. Here the risk factor is taking proton pump inhibitor also along with that particular antibiotic, then more chance of getting Clostridium difficile infection. So the post-marketing surveillance helps to establish the incidence of ADRs, and also again define some risk factors that is associated with the ADR. Then in most of the studies, age, number of drugs, sex, previous medical history, race, country, weight, alcohol intake, renal function, length of stay, and infections are also common risk factors for ADRs. So how these all they studied during the post-marketing surveillance. So we can see alcohol intake. We know that certain drugs are causing liver toxicity. So if the patient is already an alcohol intake, then the ADR of like liver toxicity would be even higher in such patients who are already taking alcohol. Then for some ADRs are more common in certain countries. Then so risk factors are also identified during the pharmacovigilance studies. Then drug interactions. Phenolones along with aluminium, calcium, magnesium and acid will reduce the absorption of the antibiotics, tetracycline and also iron. So these phenolone antibiotics, tetracycline or iron, when taken along with the calcium, aluminium or magnesium containing antacid, then absorption is reduced. So these drug interactions are also identified in the post-marketing surveillance. Then phenytoin toxic effects increase when given along with aspirin. Then phenylsin and thiamine containing food can cause hypertensive crisis. So all these drug interactions are also identified during the post-marketing surveillance. So St. John's wort is also one of the popular herbal remedy that is used for depression. So here what this particular drug does is it will induce cytochrome P450 isoenzymes. So cytochrome P450 isoenzymes are induced. Enzyme induction happens when St. John's wort is taken. It's a popular medication. It was available as over-the-counter medication also. So it is a cytochrome P450 is an enzyme inducer. So when enzyme induction happens, then it will increase the metabolism of those drugs that are substrate for it. For example, the warfarin, theophylline, cyclosporine, and many antileptics and oral contraceptives are substrates for this particular cytochrome P450 isoenzymes. So when they consume St. John's wort along with that, either increased metabolism happens. So the oral contraceptive will not work. And this warfarin, if warfarin and all are given in, like, if warfarin is not working, means what happens? There will be increased chance of bleeding. It is given as anticoagulant. So these kind of drug interactions are also identified during the post-marketing surveillance. Then another interesting thing with post-marketing surveillance is some of the new identifications, new indications are identified during the post-marketing surveillance. For example, sildenafil. Sildenafil is sildenafil can be used in pulmonary hypertension in pediatric patients. So that was determined only in the later part. Then another important, another interesting is this minoxidil. Minoxidil, we can know that minoxidil is used as, was used as antihypertensive when it was introduced in the market. Then later on, they identified that it can promote hair growth. So minoxidil is now topical. Now it is available as a topical preparation. So it is applied on hair, on head, on scalp too, and it will increase the hair growth. Now that is the main indication for minoxidil. Minoxidil nowadays not that much popular as an antihypertensive, but it is now used for hair growth. For cosmetic use, it is more popular now. So that was an indication that was found during the post-marketing surveillance. So initially, the drug would be introduced for one indication. Then during post-marketing surveillance, again, some new indication can be seen. So this aspirin was introduced as a painkiller. Later on, only during the post-marketing surveillance, they identified that aspirin has got this antiplatelet activity also. Then sildenafil citrate was used for erectile dysfunction. So again, after this, like during post-marketing surveillance only, they were able to identify it has got the potential to treat pulmonary hypertension. So minoxidil, sildenafil, aspirin, doxycycline has got some cardiac beneficial effects. All those they identified during the post-marketing surveillance studies. Then comparison with other drugs are also done in the post-marketing surveillance studies. Then different formulation, when used in different formulation, all those are studied. Then evaluation in different age groups and in pregnant women. So these information are all available during the post-marketing surveillance. Then these adverse effects such as Gray baby syndrome with chlorampheniprole, Reye's syndrome with aspirin used for viral infection. So aspirin nowadays, because of this Reye's syndrome, incidence of Reye's syndrome, aspirin should not be used in pediatric patients after any viral infections. So if the pediatric patients are were having any viral infection, any infection, then soon after that, or for even any viral infection, the aspirin should not be used because it can cause Reye's syndrome. Then in pregnant women, that metronidazole, if the in during pregnancy time, if it is exposed, then we can say that there is more chance of childhood cancer. Then this thalidomide also, which is very popular. Thalidomide was given for prevention of nausea and vomiting in pregnant women. But later, it was found that it was causing phocomedia in children. So all these important areas were identified during post-marketing surveillance only. Then we have a lot of examples such as I think sisalpiride we discussed earlier. Sisalpiride, which is a gastroprokinetic agent, which was it was introduced in 1980 and banned in 2011 due to fatal QT prolongation. Another example is fenformin. Fenformin is like metformin, same class of metformin. So anti-diabetic medication. So it was introduced in 1957. In 2003, it was banned due to lactic acidosis. Another example is gartifloxacin. Gartifloxacin is a fourth generation fluoroquinolone. Due to high risk of diabetes, it was withdrawn. Then rosiglitazone, again another anti-diabetic agent. Then due to increased incidence of heart attack, it was withdrawn. Nimesulide, which is an analgesic, because of liver toxicity, it was withdrawn. And sibutramine, anti-obesity medication, again due to increased stroke, it was withdrawn. So there are a lot of examples. Astemisol, second generation antihistamine, which was also withdrawn due to QT prolongation. So all these areas were identified during the post-marketing surveillance, and these drugs were withdrawn. Similarly, when drugs are used in when used in combination, even the combination itself is banned. Even if you search in the CDSCO, Central Blood Sugar Control site, we can see that a lot of combinations are withdrawn because that combination is causing ARIA. But the individual drugs can be used, but combinations are also withdrawn because of the ARIAs. So there are a lot of examples of banned drugs because of fatal adverse drug reactions, which was reported during the pharmacovigilance period. So phase 4 studies are equally, even more important, because we can see that a lot of adverse drug reactions are found, then long-term side effects are determined. Then, so a lot of advantages are there. We can go through once again. So I hope it is clear. Gracias.